Right, a very warm welcome to this session today titled Disability Studies in Education, a Framework for Designing Inclusive Curriculum, Pedagogy and Assessment Practices. My name is Associate Professor Anna Sullivan and I'm the Director of the Centre for Research in Educational and Social Inclusion at the University of South Australia. I'd like to open this webinar by acknowledging that the land that many of us here in South Australia are meeting on is the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past and present. The Centre for Educational and Social Inclusion is focused on contributing new knowledge about issues around educational exclusion and inclusion and those sorts of issues. We do this research with a range of interdisciplinary expertise held by our researchers. Our mission is to generate research-based knowledge to inform inclusive educational and social policy and practices across the lifespan. Our research contributes to a greater educational equity to enhance social cohesion and wellbeing. I'd like to welcome you today to this seminar, which is part of a new series, and we've got delighted to have today Professor Missy Morton, who's a Professor of Disability Studies and Inclusive Education at the University of Auckland. Very warm welcome to you, Missy. We also have today a number of people on a panel that we have organised who will engage with Missy's presentation by asking some hopefully pertinent questions. Firstly, Kerry Parker, who's Assistant Director of Disability and Learning at the Department for Education in South Australia. Can you wave there? We've lost your face there. Thanks, Kerry. And also Angela Falkenberg, who's currently the President of the South Australian Primary Principals Association. A very warm welcome to you today, Angela. Thank you. And finally, our third person on the panel is Dr. Marnie Best, who's a member of our research centre and an expert in this field. Thank you very much, Marnie. So the way that this session will be organised. Missy is going to talk and give her presentation for probably about 20 minutes, I think, Missy. And then I will turn to the panel and they will be invited to ask some key questions. And at the end of that, I'll open it up if we have time to other questions. We will be recording this seminar and we will make this recording and we'll send you an email with the details of accessing this recording later. So I'll open over to you, Missy. You should be able to share your screen and we look forward to your presentation. Thank you.
I just check that you're just seeing a screen that has a, yeah, great, thank you. Ina mana, ina reo, ina karangatanga maha, tēnā koutou. Nei te mihi ki te mana whenua, koutou o Kaurna, tēnā koutou. Ina hoki he mihi nui ki na tangara kua huihui mai nei, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Thank you to the Cressy team for the invitation to speak with you today. I began by greeting all authorities and voices, in particular acknowledging the traditional guardians of the land, the Kaitiaki, the Kaurna, the land in Adelaide. I greeted all tribes and all voices, and a special thank you to all who've joined the session. I want to acknowledge also acknowledge the funding from the Teaching and Learning Research Initiative, administered by the New Zealand Council of Educational Research. Some of what I will be talking about is a project on assessment we're currently doing with Teaching and Learning Research Initiative funding. And finally, thank you to our chair, Anna, and the panelists, Kerry, Angela, and Marnie. I'm looking forward to the conversation. So I may have gone a little off piece with the way that I've come at the presentation, but hopefully we'll touch on all of the elements that are in the title. And it's probably pulling together sort of work that I've been doing for about 15 years, both as a sociologist of special education and then working with colleagues more recently around a project called Narrative Assessment. And this is the project initially funded by the Ministry of Education as a professional learning and development, as well as a research project in the mid-2000s, but more recently under the title of using narrative assessment to support secondary teachers' inclusive practices. And I'll just read you the description of it. It's on the Teaching and Learning Research Initiative website. It's described as a project, or the aim of it is to describe how assessment-capable teachers and students drive quality teaching and learning. Where some students continue to be invisible in secondary school assessment landscapes, this is particularly the case with students with special education needs. This project focuses on encouraging and supporting teachers to be capable and confident with working when working with all students in their classes. It investigates the formative use of narrative assessment as an approach to support the recognition of all students as learners. And the students at the heart of this project are those secondary school age students. Hello? Yep, working long-term within level one of the New Zealand curriculum. And that's the sort of entry level of our curriculum. And I'm starting with this very tangible and practical outcome because I'm going to be drawing on sociology and learning about becoming an ethnographer, which is not quite the same as merely doing ethnography. I'll come back to this later. And so people don't always think of sociology as something that has particularly practical outcomes and applications. So as I said, I've been very fortunate to work with a talented group of teachers since 2007, developing this approach called narrative assessment. And I see the project as being shaped by my sociological studies, in turn shaping my sociological understandings. And this is where disability studies and education comes into play. Now you'll have seen on, also on the previous slide and on all of the slides, I've got this little box and in it is a group of sort of stick figures of different shapes and sizes. And over the top of it is text that says, community is much more than belonging to something. It's about doing something together that makes belonging matter. And Jude and I teach a course together, and this is the sort of meme, I guess, or the mantra as well of the course. And it's a bit of a kind of reminder to us that when you have policy statements that talk about inclusion and talk about belonging, it's much more than just being present. It's even more than participating. It's about doing something together that actually makes us want to be together and that makes belonging matter. So just sharing with you some of the symbolism. So the plan then is to begin with a little bit of an overview of why disability studies in education and how that both signals and makes possible some key shifts in perspectives and understandings and the way we approach the idea of belonging or being together or assessment, curriculum and pedagogy. And so the examples of difference it's making for those and then some wonderings kind of going forward. I think this will also connect with some of the key ideas from the last seminar when Pat and Ian were drawing on the work by Carol Batchy. So disability studies in education is a step away from the traditional ways of thinking about special education or disability. So it provides different ways of theorizing about disability and educational issues. And tends to look more towards things like linguistics, the humanities, the arts, the fine arts, and sociology is one of those steps away from traditional special education and traditional approaches to defining problems. And this for me is the connection with the seminar, the last seminar, where they asked of policy, what's the problem represented to be? So Jude and I also use Carol Bunchy's work in our own teaching. And within the realm of praxis, disability studies and education works to create and sustain inclusive and accessible schools. But we think one of the questions has to be, what else is going on here? Rather than focusing on a student or a group of students or even a group of students and their families, as the problem, we want to think about what else might be going on here that's making it challenging for teachers and principals or educators to think about how we can better promote the participation and belonging for all of the students. So what else might be going on here? Where else might we start? So I'm now drawing on the work of Simi Linton, who's a disability studies scholar from the US. And she's asked us to think about the claim that the measure of a society might be the mechanisms it uses to protect its most vulnerable. And she suggests that we should flip that on its head and think that a more productive analysis might come through considering the mechanisms that a society uses to make disabled people economically vulnerable, powerless, and isolated, and consider what the use of those mechanisms says about a society. So going back to this idea of disability studies and education, saying, well, what else might be going on, rather than thinking about the child as vulnerable as a condition of something inherent in the child, we're starting to think about, well, what might the mechanisms that our society uses actually create those vulnerabilities. And so in my work, the mechanisms that I've been particularly interested in are our practices, beliefs, ideas, and values, the intersecting discourses in curriculum, pedagogy, and assessment. So how do we then go about understanding the ways we make sense of curriculum, pedagogy, and assessment? And how do we understand the ways we make sense of differences? And we want to do that because we want to understand how those mechanisms act or enacted to make disabled people economically vulnerable, powerless, and isolated. But for the purposes of this presentation, I'm just going to be focusing on what that looks like in schools. So what else might be going on here? I'm now going to start thinking about how we might shift perspectives and shape meanings and drawing on disability studies in education. So in 1959, Mills's book, The Sociological Imagination, was published. And his call for sociological imagination was the call to understand that the personal is more often than not political. His main point was that many of the problems people are faced with in society have social and political roots, and these problems are shared by many others. The roots of problems are often related to the structure of the society and the changes happening within it. Sociologists and other social scientists have an important role in demonstrating why and how these problems have sociological causes, enabling the individual to understand how their biography is linked to the structure and history of society. Understanding these connections help individuals and groups to transform personal, quote, misfortune into public issues in order to facilitate social change. And when sociologists of education work with students learning to become teachers, we generally want to engage them with critical theory, for example, providing examples of sociological studies that present the interpretations of our own and other ethnographers who examine education and education-related issues. And this is a good start. We've been asking teachers to think beyond the common sense understanding given to individual students or group of students, their families, and communities. We've been asking students to think about what might be the deep structures of education, the rituals, the ways of talking about, the everyday practices in schools and classrooms that perpetuate exclusion, even while assuming that it's only natural that some children and young people are never present in our classrooms. The deep structures that I want to encourage students to refuse to take for granted are our rituals and everyday practices around curriculum, pedagogy, and assessment, and the role of these particular beliefs and practices in perpetuating exclusion. I want to encourage student teachers to recognize deficit discourses at work when they locate problems of learning, participation, achievement as inherent problems within groups, or defining membership of particular groups as the cause of failure. Now, this isn't a new idea. You think, for example, of ethnography such as Paul Willis's work in the UK in the 1970s in his book, Learning to Labour, How Working Class Kids Get Working Class Jobs. In New Zealand, for example, we look to researchers like Alison Jones, a colleague at the University of Auckland, and her work in the 1980s and her book, At School I've Got a Chance, Pacific Islands and Pākehā Girls at School. So my questions, and I'll come back to these, I'll encourage us to think about these at the end. These are the questions that have been driving my work. So if one meaning of research is to deepen one's understanding of what is going on here, then what else helps teachers, including ourselves, to do this? I wonder how teachers might use the understandings and tools of ethnography in their everyday practices. For example, how might teachers who have completed projects or theses using the tools and understandings of ethnography to continue to use what they've learned in the classrooms? How might teachers move only beyond only using the substantive findings of a thesis project or its implications for classroom practices? And what does it mean to think like an ethnographer more than do ethnography? But some starting possibilities include questions like, how are we making sense together of what is going on here? What meanings do we take for granted? And what meanings could we resist and refuse? And what might make it possible to think like an ethnographer while in the moment of teaching and learning, planning curriculum, carrying out and acting upon assessment? How might thinking like an ethnographer contribute to being a reflective and reflexive practitioner? I want to acknowledge there's two sources for the idea of thinking, for the idea of thinking like an ethnographer when we think about teaching and learning in our own and others' classrooms. The first is an article by Bill Wonsart I read 20 years ago and then relatively recently rediscovered. And the second is the 10-year plus project working with teachers to develop a national resource in New Zealand using narrative assessment. I'll just turn to Bill Wonsart's work for a moment. His article in 1995 was titled Teaching as a Way of Knowing, Observing and Responding to Students' Abilities. And it was published in a special issue of Remedial and Special Education. Wonsart opens his paper stating, teacher research is about the knowledge created when teachers seek to discover the stories that students reveal about themselves as learners. Teacher researchers observe and describe the details of individual learners within the context of the classroom, the family, and the community. Teacher researchers collect and combine their observations so that they may understand and interpret what students are telling them about their learning. Their primary purpose is to allow these stories of ability to change their teaching as they respond to their developing understanding of each student. This understanding of assessment as a way of getting to know students is a much needed antidote to the insistence on supposedly objective, neutral, accountability-driven assessment agendas still dominating the New Zealand, Australia, US, UK, and other countries. I'd add that a focus on getting to know students is also an important antidote to continuing to think about some students as the stranger to be feared, to be turned away, sent away, so often pervasive in political discourse today. Now, Wonsart is, of course, describing the tools of ethnography, participant observation with its rich description of context and conversations. He's also describing the aims of ethnography, to understand the perspective of participants and the meanings they make of and give to their lives. Wonsart also draws on the work of Ferguson and Taylor, interpreting disability, a qualitative reader in particular, and concluding with these authors that one purpose of telling stories, particularly the stories of traditionally disadvantaged groups, is to make a difference to how teachers see their work, with the explicit purpose of improving what happens in the classroom. Wonsart notes that when teachers report their work about listening to students' stories, they often tell transformative stories. In deciding which stories will prevail in the narrative, teacher researchers present evidence that students' stories can prevail if teachers attend to them. When shared in this way, the understandings of student ability and accomplishment that teachers develop in the classroom may additionally influence the instructional practices of other teachers who recognize those stories. Now, one of the key concepts in constructing ethnographic accounts are these idea of critical incidents. And Holquist and Busanti describe critical incidents as turning points that challenge the researcher and create opportunities for knowing. They note that critical incidents are created rather than simply out there waiting to be discovered or uncovered. What makes a particular incident critical is our interpretation of the significance of an event. The element of surprise is usually a key element in deciding that an incident is critical. The surprise can in turn invite reflection on the event and deeper analysis of the event. And participants may identify and make visible aspects of their own lives and or practice that may be hidden or have gone unnoticed. I'm going to turn briefly now to some examples of how we've been supporting teachers to create narratives in order to make sense of things they see, hear, and understand in everyday teaching. So first I'm going to talk about the narrative assessment projects. Our project on narrative assessment turned to understanding the experiences of children labeled as having, quote, special education needs. And these needs are special because they're constructed as not fitting within the common sense everyday rituals, thinking, practices in today's schools and classrooms. Using narrative assessment, teachers are invited to look at their students and their students' learning through a somewhat different lens. This approach to assessment is based on an understanding of curriculum and learning that's co-constructed, contextual, and interactional. This approach differs from more traditional understandings of learning as demonstrating progression, that teachers already know what the learning will look like for every student, and assessment is about looking and listening for evidence of that learning. In narrative assessment, a different kind of attention is called for, that of attending to, listening to, a student or a group of students. Wayne Beck describes this as a loving attention. And learning to write the narratives of learning for students with special education needs. Teachers were encouraged in this project first to write little jottings or take photos of what they considered to be wow moments in the life of our classroom. So in the first project, we worked with 26 teachers. We were supporting the teachers to notice things that students had done. The teachers in the project then met as a group to share and talk about these wow moments in their classrooms or on the playgrounds. To think about the critical incidents, things that surprised them. And describing why the moment was wow for them, the teachers then describe what they thought they already knew about the students and the stories, and how they previously documented students' lack of learning, and how these had led to low expectations. We encouraged the teachers to elaborate further on their jottings and stories. What else was going on? What were they, the teachers and story writers, doing at the time? We encourage the teachers to put themselves, their ideas, their feelings into the stories. When we then met with other teachers who were familiar with aspects of the New Zealand curriculum, the curriculum facilitators, they and the teacher story writers began to identify how a story of stories linked to the various learning areas of the New Zealand curriculum. We were supporting the teacher story writers to recognize these wow moments as students showing what they were learning or had sometimes learned long ago, and the teachers were only now recognizing as learning. For all of us involved in the development of these examples of narrative assessment, the experiences of noticing and recognizing student learning were electrifying. And the website for the resource is called Two Different Eyes. This was a phrase the teachers used repeatedly to describe how they now saw their students. The students were now ascribed identities as learners, and the teacher's teacher story writers also sell themselves differently, also as learners and as advocates for their students. So in shifting teachers' perspectives and shaping new meanings, the teachers on the project described the assessment that they were now involved with as meaningful, providing them with valuable information to reflect on their teaching and to consider next steps for student learning. It supported building positive relationships with family through valuing family's input, because learning also happens outside the classroom, and providing families with stories that celebrated students' learning. Our experiences on this project were consistent with those reported by other writers looking at the conditions that shape teachers' understanding and enacting sociocultural perspectives on curriculum pedagogy and assessment. Changing and contested understandings of assessment, curriculum, and pedagogy highlight the interrelatedness of these concepts. Broadfoot, for example, argues that assessment models work to shape the way that people think about and practice education. Kathleen and Richardson claim that we can only transform curriculum and pedagogy by transforming the way that we assess learning. Willis notes that within the family of sociocultural theoretical perspectives, learning is viewed as social participation within a community of practice, something to belong to. An assessment for learning becomes participative pedagogy, where teachers and students are learning from and with each other. And once we see all children as learners, it's pretty much impossible to go back to the old ways of seeing them as not capable or not competent. Narrative assessment may help teachers to move from pedagogical discourses of deviance focused on identifying and solving the problems of individual difference, the pedagogical discourses of inclusion, where difference is valued, celebrated, and drawn on to enhance our curriculum and pedagogy. Combined with opportunities to work as members of learning communities that include children, their families, and educators, narrative assessment can provide all the learners and educators in that community with a chance to see and be seen as active and competent learners, actively contributing to the center of life, to the life of early childhood centers and schools. So adapting this framework moved the teachers' recounts of observations beyond mere description of what they already knew was there. This perspective supported documented moments of surprise and the creation of critical incidents. The wow moments could be noticed and recognized as learning. Sharing the stories of learning created new and more enriching possibilities for students, teachers, and families. The 26 teachers in the early project and the teachers from the three secondary settings that we're working with now have described the impact on them of learning to think in different ways about what they pay attention to and how they pay attention. Some of these teachers went on to complete theses using ethnography to pay further attention to how teaching and learning are being co-constructed for students in regular schools and classrooms. We suspect that one implication from this work is that we don't wait for graduate school to teach teachers about qualitative research or to limit reading of qualitative research to studies on the sociology of education. So what are we using now from what we've learned from this? Well, we are actually embedding interpretivist approaches in our initial teacher education programs at both undergraduate and graduate level, and with our teachers doing postgraduate studies with us for further qualifications. And a more recent project in these courses has been an assignment asking student teachers or working teachers, experienced teachers, that specifically attend to culture in their practice settings. We ask our students, what have you noticed about a culture of belonging in your setting? How is a culture of belonging and a culture of learning being built or maintained in your setting? We ask them to document a puzzle of practice, an encounter, an incident, or a string of incidents. We provide them with a range of conceptual frameworks which they can choose to help them make sense of to interpret their experiences. And the conceptual frameworks, not surprisingly, all come from ethnographies of schools and classrooms. And our students sometimes eventually tell us that this is the most practical course they've ever taken. The students completing these assignments also describe how they are learning about what they are taking for granted as common sense educational rituals, routines, and practices. I believe that using ethnographic ways of thinking so that we may better understand the connections between the personal experience of students and teachers and the social contexts, rituals, routines, and practices in which we live and learn can help individuals and groups to transform personal misfortune into public issues to better facilitate social change. Thank you. I hope I kept
it. Thank you very much, Missy. I'm juggling a couple of screens here. That was very, very fascinating. I'm going to go straight to the panel. Everyone's moved. Kerry, I'm going to ask you. Kerry, just for those who joined a bit later, Kerry Parker, who's the Assistant Director of the Department for Education in South Australia and in the area of disability and learning. So, Kerry, I invite you to ask a question to Missy, please.
Thank you, Anna, and thank you, Missy, for that very interesting presentation you just gave. from a person who's in a position of, I suppose, influencing the department and the directions and the strategic planning for children with disability in our system, your research and evidence that you've found, how would you suggest that we could implement some of those findings? What do you think we should focus on to make a difference to the inclusion of children with disability and their learning?
Good question, Kerry.
Yep. Oh, thank you, Anna.
It's an excellent question.
Yeah.
No, it's a great question. And I think one of the things that we've learned out of this is that if you want to make the biggest difference to curriculum and pedagogy, you need to change what you do by way of assessment. And it's not just the actual practices of assessment, it's the belief and attitudes about what the purposes of assessment are.
So, how does that fit within a sort of a national testing regime that we've also got? Does it fit in conjunction with that?
Well, we have one of those. We have those in New Zealand as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's mostly at our last 3 years of secondary school, a series of exams that students have, and plus internal assessment. So this comes back to the question of what's the purpose of assessment, or what are the purposes of assessment, and how do they compete, and what tensions can you resolve, and which are some of the ones you have to live with, but you want to mitigate the worst effects of it. So where assessment is fundamentally about gatekeeping and allowing who's in or who's out, then the purpose is to exclude.
Mm-hmm.
So you probably don't want that to be the only thing that drives what happens in your classrooms and schools. So we think what narrative assessment does is it's a very good formative approach to assessment. It starts from the idea that to be a good teacher, you need to have good relationships and know your students. And so you want forms of assessment that actually support and promote that.
Thanks, Missy.
Change the assessment, or at least think about it. Yeah.
I'll come back to you, Kerry, in a minute. Angela Falkenberg, who's president of the South Australian Primary Principals Association. So would you like to ask Missy a question, Angela?
Yeah, look, thank you, Missy. What a beautiful thing you've described, that a parent knows a teacher sees their child as full of wow. I think that's just wonderful. So what works do you think to enable teachers to understand the lived experience of the child and family? You know, how do we get that conversation started on about the strengths?
As I said, what we started with this project is that we started with teachers who were working with students who were considered to not belong in the New Zealand curriculum, for whom all parts and forms of assessment, you know, made no sense, and whose curriculum, and I use this in a very loose sense of the word, was largely very functional curriculums, or just goals from their IEPs chopped up into tiny, teeny, tiny little steps. And, you know, that used to be my job, doing that kind of work. So I speak from experience. And so instead, we asked them to start, as I said, to start thinking about what's something that surprised you, which usually it surprised them because it wasn't expected. And because they were not expecting the young person to show any learning that connected to the curriculum. So once we put them together with people who had a deep knowledge, especially of the earlier stages of the curriculum, and so that person could say, so not a special educator, somebody with a deep knowledge of the curriculum areas, we're now advising teachers to see that actually connects. Doesn't this speak to some of the learning objectives of getting to know your community and the social sciences? Doesn't this, taking another person's perspective, maybe speak to some of the things you might see in the dramatic arts? So instead of just thinking of these things as being kind of not relevant or not connected, why couldn't those be evidence, if that's the word that people needed to use, that a child was showing you something that they knew and could do? So part of what happened and the way this began to then influence pedagogy is that we started talking about what's our role as educators to provide context for students to show us what they know and can do. So that's part of how assessment can shift what we think of by way of pedagogy. I have to say there are a number of principals involved with all the schools that we've worked with over the years, Angela, and they made decisions to stop doing some of the forms of assessment that they've been required to do. I'm not quite sure how they navigated that, because they found the narrative assessment a far more meaningful way to report to families.
Thanks, Angela and Missy. I'll just turn to Marnie Best, who's one of the researchers in our centre. Marnie, would you like to ask a question?
Thanks, Anna. Thanks, Angela. Also, Kerry, we see the work that you're doing in this space is certainly most interesting, and we can definitely see how adopting disability studies in education framework can really support us to identify gaps in theory and practice, and how this then has potential to hopefully filter through to our practice in schools and classrooms, and then in time through policy as well. So my question is building on both Kerry's and Angela's a little, but in the different but related context of higher ed. Are you able to talk a little bit more about how a disability studies and education framework might be enacted to support us to reimagine how we scaffold our pre-service teachers to more broadly understand how they can adopt inclusive practice, and perhaps how we can then further our understanding and our notions of inclusive curriculum, pedagogy, assessment that really recognise and challenge what you spoke about before with deficit discourses and as inherent problems?
A long question, Marnie.
Sorry, it was. I've been thinking for too long, Missy, but there's plenty to cover.
So within the in pre-service, so, you know, with new teachers,
right.
We try to make sure that in courses that talk about sociology and philosophy of education, so it's not just the instrumental kind of or strategy kind of approaches, we make sure that history of exclusion and inclusion around disabilities as much a part of the work as our stuff on anti-racist education and the impacts of colonization, so that people understand that these are wider social issues and structures that, you know, that schools are set up, what the history, you know, how the history of schooling has not always been inclusive. We also try to point to other kinds of philosophical traditions that are more inclusive than the ones that typically dominate schooling systems at the moment. So we make lots of links to Indigenous forms of knowing and pedagogy as well. Even when we're in the sort of curriculum areas, we try to make explicit how theories of learning shape who we believe can be a learner, and how our theories of learning impact on pedagogy and curriculum. Right, so the idea that if you think learning is just transmission, your pedagogy is going to form that, and you're going to go for curriculum areas that allow you to just transmit, because that's what works for that, that's what aligns. And I mean, I just try to infuse sociology into everything that I can, but also to make the point that if you learn to see things differently, it makes it possible for you to enact things differently. Not sure if I answered all the elements of your question.
Well, it's a big question, I think, Missy. So we'll go back to Kerry. Kerry, I'll ask you to ask one more question, please.
I'm not quite sure how to frame this. What we do when we talk to our teachers is it's almost like that chicken or egg circumstance. Is it the culture and attitudes that come first, or practice comes first? If you change practice, then your cultures and attitudes change, or your attitudes and culture change, and therefore you change in practice. So we're always, I suppose, thinking about how we can support our teachers to have more, and leaders to have more inclusive practices. You know, what comes first? Which one do we work on first to see the difference for teachers in our schools and preschools? Does that question make sense, Missy?
It does make sense. And it's certainly one that I grappled with for ages as well. And I think the answer is that you have to work on them at the same time. Mm-hmm. And so all the teachers on our narrative assessment projects, you know, they fundamentally wanted to include all of their students, and they often couldn't understand necessarily why it was working. So you could certainly say, you know, that they had the heart for it.
Yep. Yep.
And they also kind of had a conviction that their kids were learning, but they just had no way of showing it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And alongside that, if you don't see someone as a learner, you wonder what on earth they're doing in your classroom.
Mm.
But seeing someone as a learner is one of those threshold moments. Once you've crossed that threshold, there's no going back. So it's finding strategies that will support teachers to see everyone in their classroom as a learner, even the ones who on first glance look least like a learner. Then you can start to wrap some of the other stuff around it, I think.
Yeah. Thank you, Missy.
Thank you. Angela, would you like to ask another question?
Yeah, look, I'm really interested in that notion of belonging and, you know, that it is together in what matters. So I guess, you know, what's your thinking about students being able to respond or give feedback on a sense of belonging?
Oh, I think it's absolutely essential that they give feedback on what that means. Yeah.
So thoughts about how that's, I don't want to use the word measured, but I guess what we're saying is, you know, what are indications that students might give, particularly if they're nonverbal, for example, on belonging, because we can often assume they are, but we're not in their head.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. Well, sometimes for children who don't have a means of communicating, the kids around them might be able to say whether or not, you know, they might read the children, they might know their peers quite well. There's lots of strategies that people have used. So they've given kids cameras and asked them to go take photos of places where your favorite parts of school, and sometimes they can be quite surprising to teachers what turns up in the photos, or parts of the school we didn't know existed sometimes. And then invite other kids to talk about them.
Thank you.
What sorts of things have you seen so far, Angela?
You know, we have a part of our wellbeing and assessment tool for students does talk about belonging. But you know, we know that sort of psychological safety and cultural safety is so critical to, you know, connection to school. And I guess without ways to measure, we're only assuming. And so, you know, if you're talking about the point about the photos is great. Even, you know, in sociograms, if no other child is identifying that child as someone in a friendship group, you know, they're red flags, but it's getting from the child how safe they feel and therefore how invested they're willing to be in belonging.
And I think the other part of that question is that what looks and feels like belonging for you and me might not feel like belonging for the next person, and that belonging's not a forever thing. It's constantly fluid and changing and shifting. So you could have a disgusting day and feel like you don't belong, and then the next morning everything's okay again.
Thank you.
Marnie, would you like to ask one more question, please?
I'll ask a really quick question this time, Missy. So based on the findings of this project, what's next?
I lost the last part of your sentence. Based on the findings of this project, that's right. What's next?
What's next?
Well, we'll keep doing narrative assessment, professional learning and development with as many schools who will have us. And we're making some resources to put online for teachers. Mm-hmm. So they'll be available for anybody to access from anywhere. But I think the bigger piece of it is continuing to sort of better document some of the work that we're doing in both our in-service and pre-service teaching, embedding these ideas of thinking like an ethnographer as part of our work, our everyday work of teaching and learning. It's not something you just do when you do your thesis and then you don't do it ever again. So trying to figure out what that might might look like for people.
Thank you, Missy. I'm aware that we've actually got people here from, looked at some of the comments from New South Wales, from all around Australia, but all around the world. And I'm sure there are lots of other people who have a question. And I guess what it makes me think is you know, how is this contextualised for different contexts? And I wondered if that's an issue, Missy, or if it's something that could be brought in to any learning environment.
Well, I see Karen Meyer was asking, what do we mean by level one of the curriculum? And Jules, who's a Kiwi, has answered that's the first year of schooling, but not only. I mean, people might be working at level one in particular different curriculum areas, and level four in a different area.
Yeah. Are there any questions? I might just open that up. But does anyone have a question? I noticed a few people on screen. And Karen, did you have a question?
I'm just fascinated about this because it took me a while to realise the cohort, and now I have. I'm like, yay, see you rock, because we're doing something very similar in New South Wales. We're designing an accessible student voice survey for kids who are nonverbal, but you know, even for kids who don't have English language as their first language, using photo voice, body mapping, accessible survey methods, because really, collect their voice, find out where they belong. And when you started talking about the photo voice, I was like, yeah, we're all over this. And we're doing some other work. So it's really, really super duper important. And it just made everything else you said just fall into place. So thank you. And thanks to Jules for giving me that fantastic advice all the way through too. Because I was like, who's the cohort? But yes, but great work. Keep it up. Looking forward to the results.
The other piece of that, Kieran, is that that I probably didn't mention is that once those narrative assessments start with the teachers telling the stories of the wow moments, but then those stories go home and parents add to it and the students add to it and student siblings add to it. So all kinds of ways of documenting and recording from all sources get wrapped up in this.
Sorry, I was just going to ask a question. How are the teachers, are they like, what do you call it? Like publicizing the stuff around the school, or how are they sharing these wow moment stories or like books, or how are they sharing them?
Well, they happen all kinds of ways. Sometimes they're done electronically. Do you have Story Park in your neck of the woods or EduCal?
I haven't heard of it, but sounds cool.
Yeah, so there are ways, there are electronic means that schools have for sharing students' work with family and with students and more broadly. So that's one way that this work's published and shared. We've seen classrooms where one teacher has a wall, a story wall, and so they've got narrative assessments, not just so the kids long-term level one, but also, and they use them for everybody in the class. Mm-hmm. And the wall is just filled with individual stories of learning or group stories of learning. Some schools have chosen to use this as their reporting mechanism when reports go home to families. So there's a printed portfolio as well as an electronic portfolio, so families can share them around.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the question as well, Sierra. Any other questions or comments? Kerry, have you got another one while you've got an opportunity?
Probably it's more a comment than anything. The art of observation, I think, is possibly Missy at the core of what you're talking about. It's if you don't observe and you don't notice and you don't take in every tiny little bit that you see, you hear, you feel, you sense with the students and being really in tune with them, then you miss much of the communication. And I think that that is absolutely core to the assessment.
I think you're right. I absolutely agree with you. And I think it's a different kind of observation, certainly to the kind of observation I was initially trained to do as a psychologist. It's a very different kind of observation. Mm. And sometimes, I guess, maybe coming back to the question of how do you support teachers to make these shifts, they need the time to just hang out, which is what you do, you know, just hang out and watch and listen and look to rather than look for. Get the rid of the mental checklist and just be there.
I might go back to Angela, actually, because Angela, the pressure, I've had conversations with you in the past about the pressure to work and be busy. How do you think that plays out for principals in your association to allow teachers the space to do this?
You know, space is an interesting word, because if there's ever space, we want to fill it. And so that idea of noticing, you know, which you could see as a passive space, is actually highly rigorous. You know, what you're talking about, Missy, is really deep, you know, being present and focused. And it's not going to fit comfortably with what you call the accountability assessment agendas. You know, I often think with children that we're very restless in education. We're never quite happy with where they are. We always want them to go somewhere else. So, you know, it's a really different way of thinking, and I think it's so exciting. And there will be schools that would be willing to, you know, have a go at this. Yeah. But how you defend it against perhaps another framework will be the challenge.
Yeah, and it's making the case for is what we're doing now doing everything we need it to be, we need it to do. What else could we do?
Yeah. Thanks. I noticed Kerry nodding there. I'll go to you, Beth. You've got your hand up.
Thank you. Hi, Beth Sprunt. I'm based a couple of hours southwest of Melbourne, but I wrote in the chat, there's a bunch of us on the call. Apart from me, the rest are Fijians, but I work with the team in Fiji. And we're mainly sort of in the special and inclusive education space, although not all of us. But the assessment policy is being revised. The Ministry of Education's assessment policy is being revised currently. And it's a really great opportunity for us to try to build into that very mainstream policy. Currently it mentions that some reasonable accommodations, children are eligible to have those, and if schools are aware of them, and if communications work between the principal and the ministry, then they can get access to those. But clearly we need it to go much beyond that. You know, there's a whole lot of question marks around how do we make sure that assessment is working for inclusion. And so my question is, how do you bring your findings and your perspective into policy? Like, what does that look like for a system which is not very, very familiar really with inclusion, that's relatively nascent?
I think one of the things that helped us with this is that we were able to make clear links to Indigenous traditions around stories, and stories having power if you want to shape and change things. And we when we were looking for examples of people's understanding of learning, we didn't ask them to count things or measure things. We just asked for stories. And then as we got more and more stories, that's when we started bringing in, well, here's another way of thinking about those stories in terms of what does it show us about what somebody understands? Because so often, if somebody doesn't look and move and speak in the ways that we're used to thinking of as demonstrating learning, we assume there is no learning. Right. So, yeah. So it's kind of using the stories to sort of rethink about what it is we're seeing and how it could be evidence of learning. I hope that makes sense.
Well, no, it totally makes sense. It's probably quite a leap. Like, I think this is giving us a lot we need to think about and talk about. I completely agree. Like, I feel the way that assessment is done is so exclusive. Like, it really pushes a lot of kids out. But building that bridge to what you're talking about feels like we've got a bit of work to do. But thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks, Beth. Audrey?
Hello, good morning. It's morning here in Ireland. And thank you Missy and everybody following your work for some time. So my question is a little different, perhaps in terms of in teacher education or at faculty level, how have you managed to reach that hegemony of we can get teachers, or I can get teachers in some modules, you know, to be really interested in this and really excited about it, but they're in a world where, you know, a majority of people want all the measurements. Have you any tips on how to convince one's colleagues or the broader university structure?
Well, that's tough, right? But I think it's about finding our allies, and there'll be other people, other groups of students and learners and families and teachers who are systematically discriminated against by our assessment systems. And it's not about making accommodations to participate in fundamentally exclusive systems of assessment. It's about making the case, if you say you really want to know your learners because that promotes learning, how well are these assessment strategies allowing us to do that? Or are the assessment strategies that we are using now actually making barriers to getting to know our students? That's how we made the shift. We didn't say assessment was bad. We just said, what assessment would work better for us if the goal is to form genuine teaching and learning relationships with students and families? I think that's how we made it work.
Thank you, Audrey. I'm going to pull this to a close now. Thank you very much, Missy. You know, it's really exciting to see people who are interested in your research from all around the world. I'm really grateful to the panelists who've asked some quite insightful questions that really sort of contextualise it from different perspectives. And Chris Woods has put a comment. There's a number of comments and I haven't got through them all, but he said, or she said, imagine if all school reports had to include wow moments. It's an interesting thing because in Australia, we have all teachers have to report twice a year on student learning. And in that, it was possibly a good intention, but it's become quite mechanically listic. And as a parent, I just think it doesn't show anything about my child. And so repersonalizing, I think you said that narrative assessment is a way of making meaningful assessment that can actually inform teaching and is valuable to students and parents. I think that's what you said. And to transform curriculum and teaching by transforming assessment is a really good way to think about it. So your use of research in the profession is really astounding. Thank you very much, Missy. Thank you very much, Marnie, as well, Marnie Best, for organising this event. It's really useful. We'll be having more, and you're all very welcome to come in our conversations around inclusion and exclusion. So thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.